Good morning. A warm welcome to all the participants in this online lecture number 3 of the web lecture series organized by the Department of English, Shivabharati Mahavidyalaya. Myself, Rick Shorkar, Assistant Professor of English. On behalf of the Department of English, I take this opportunity to extend my sincerest gratitude to Babulal Mahato, SDO Jhargram, and administrator, as well as an important member of the governing body, for his unflinching support. My sincerest thanks and my deepest gratitude to also the Honorable Principal Dev Prasad Sao for his words of inspiration. It's truly an honor and a privilege to have Dr. Devdash Roy, Associate Professor, Department Head of Shukumar Sen Mahavidyalaya, Keshpur, Poshim Mednipur. And a mention must be made of Dr. Shomit Kumar Maiti, who is the moderator of this particular web lecture, as well as the other members of the department, Lokhikanto Chatterjee, Mr. Tonmoy Sarkar, Mr. Shubhankar Acharya, without whose cooperation this web lecture would not have seen the light of the day. And finally, to the participants who have made it an attempt to be a part of this web lecture, in order to make it a grand success. Today's lecture is about moving beyond the heteronormative discourse of gender towards a space which is characterized by gender fluidity. And the need of the hour is to integrate the, to normalize the queer, to look at them not as queer, but as normal. And that is the attitude that should be cultivated by us. And therefore, without further delay, I request Dr. Shomit Kumar Maiti, Departmental Head of Shivabharati Mahavidyalaya Kapgari, to kindly introduce our speaker to the audience. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Rik Babu. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the online lecture number 3 of the online lecture series organized by the Department of English, Shivabharati Mahavidyalaya, Kapgari, Jhargram, West Bengal. I am Dr. Shomit Kumar Maiti, Assistant Professor and Head of the Department, and also the convener of the online lecture series conducted by the English Department, Shivabharati Mahavidyalaya. On behalf of the English Department, I would like to express my heartfelt gratitude to the Honorable Administrator, Mr. Babulal Mahato, and to Dr. Deva Prasad Sahu, the Principal of Shivabharati Mahavidyalaya, and also the patron of this online lecture series, for giving his consent to organize this event and for his kind cooperation and constant motivation. My deepest gratitude and hearty thanks to the distinguished speaker of today's lecture, Dr. Devdash Roy, Associate Professor and Head, Department of English, Shukumar Sen Gupta Mahavidyalaya, Keshpur, Poshim Mednipur, West Bengal, for accepting our invitation to deliver the third lecture of the online lecture series. I convey my thanks to the participants, departmental teachers, and each and every member of the academic community of the college. Special thanks to the members of the Alumni Association. Dear participants, we all know that the outbreak of COVID-19 pandemic has severely affected almost every sector, particularly the education sector. Keeping in mind the academic well-being of the students of the English Department of the college, this is our humble effort to organize the online lecture to cater to the needs of the students in this hour of crisis when they are home-locked and when they cannot attend regular physical classes. I ensure that the lecture will be profitable for everyone, particularly for the students of fourth semester under BA, CBCS, I mean, choice-based credit system of Vidyasagar University, introduced by Vidyasagar University. The topic of today's lecture is, who is Funny Boy? Who is funny in Funny Boy? A queer reading of Sam Salvadori's Funny Boy. Now, without much ado, let me introduce today's speaker, Dr. Devdas Roy, to all of you. Dr. Roy is a brilliant scholar, a distinguished academician, and an excellent speaker. Dr. Roy is Associate Professor and Head, Department of English, Sukumar Sengupta Mahavidyalaya, Keshpur, Poshchim Medinipur, and guest teacher, Department of English, Vidyasagar University. Dr. Roy also served Y.S. Palpara Mahavidyalaya as Assistant Professor in English for nearly 7 years. He did his PhD on John Donne's poetry and sermons at the Department of English, Vidyasagar University, under the supervision of Professor Tirthankar Daspurakarasthan. He has a fairly good number of publications to his credit. He is the chief editor of MediFlight, a peer-reviewed journal approved by the UGC. Dr. Devdas Roy has authored 2 books jointly with Dr. Pritha Kundu. The books are Understanding Romantic Poetry, A Critical Reader, and Shakespeare in Focus, in commemoration of the centenary of Shakespeare's death. So, with this introduction, I now request Dr. Devdas Roy to kindly begin his lecture. Dr. Devdas Roy.
Thank you, Dr. Shomit Kumar Maiti, who is a close acquaintance of mine as a known figure in the academia, for kindly introducing me precisely. And I also thank Rick Sarkar. Rick has very succinctly but precisely introduced the focus of my talk. It is a fit introduction to what I am going to talk about. It is indeed an honor and a privilege to share the platform with you and to be a part of this online lecture series. And I congratulate the administrator, I congratulate the organizers, the departmental teachers, and especially Dr. Shomit Kumar Maiti, who I believe is not only the convener, but the mastermind of this online lecture series, and also Rick Sarkar and others. Now, Dr. Shomit Kumar Maiti has rightly said that this is meant for the students. I have designed my lecture for the students. So it's a kind of simplistic kind of talk, which is, I mean, anyone who wants to find anything or look for anything scholarly may be frustrated. I confess that it is futile to look for anything scholarly. This talk is primarily meant for the students. With these words, let's get started with the question, who is funny in the Funny Boy? You know, is the boy R.G. Selvaratnam only funny? Or there are other funny characters and institutions, funny people in the novel? Apart from its book title, you know, the word funny has been used 8 times in the novel, 8 times. And the book has been told in 6 chapters, and it recounts, the novel recounts RG's relocation to Canada following the 1983 riots, which posed a threat to his family to his community and to the Tamil minority. Indeed, all the six books of the novel, all the six chapters of the novel focus on Arji's experience. Come to the chapter, Peaks Cannot Fly. Peaks Can't Fly, the opening chapter, the opening book. In this book, you come across certain funny aspects in R.G. Selvaratnam's character. You find that he prefers the territory of the girls, the second territory of the girls. He prefers to play bride. He prefers to watch his mother while she's dressing. He prefers to appreciate her, his mother's feminine charm, feminine beauty. He prefers to live in a kind of fantasy world. And in the bride game, he is the bride. So, in the chapter Peaks Can't Fly, he displays, or some of his funny, some of his strange, unusual, different aspects come to the fore. Not only that, while he watches his mother dressing, he pretends to wear the jewelry, his mother's jewelry. So, in the chapter, second chapter, also Radha Aunty, in the chapter Radha Aunty, he also befriends Radha Aunty, and Radha Aunty decorates him, he decorates his face, and he is ecstatic over the fact. He is very overjoyed to think that a real marriage is going to take place, and he will see a real bride. So these things are there. And not only that, when Tonuja comes, he shows off his fingers. His fingers and his nails having nail polish or color. And not only that, he goes to the rehearsal, not for any interest in drama, but for makeup. He's interested in makeup. So the second chapter also. The third chapter also, in the third chapter also, we come across certain features which are funny. In the third chapter, we find that he's interested in reading Little Women. When his father asks him, "What are you interested in? I mean, I'm going to Europe. What shall I purchase for you?" Then he says that, "I want the sequels to Little Women." In the next chapter, fourth chapter, Small Choices, there also R.G. admires the beauty of Jigan. He feels a kind of attraction for Jigan, how built he was, and he looks at his tight thighs, thigh muscles, and trousers, etc. So, not only that, R.G.'s father discusses with Jigan about R.G.'s tendency to play with dollies, play with dolls, and read books, etc. The next chapter, the base school of all, here also you come across how R.G. realizes his same-sex desire, and he experiences a kind of homosexual relationship with Sehan, his classmate. I now knew that kiss was something connected to what we had in common, he says. And Sehan had known this all along. So this clearly proves that in this chapter, this clearly is suggestive of R.G.'s inclination towards homosexuality, his homosexual bent of mind. In the Riot Journal epilogue, there also, you do not come across any such tendency there, but the novel ends with the Riot Journal epilogue, which records the historical communal riots. And this is a diary And whose diary is it? RG's diary. So RG is at the center. It is said that we set out with the question, who is funny in Funny Boy? Now, we can say, analyzing all the chapters, it is evident RG is the funny boy. The novel is a kind of Bildungsroman, you might say. It begins in 1972 when RG is only seven, only a young boy. And the novel ends at a time when RG is a young adult. So the novel traces, as you know, and the novel, in this novel, RG's desire for sexuality, RG's desire and sexuality is interwoven with politics and ethnicity in the years of turmoil. So the obvious answer to the question that is posed at the beginning is that who is funny? So all will say criticism relies on the funniness of Archie. But titles are sometimes misleading. We tend to be deluded by titles. The fact is that the novel's funniness is a critical phenomenon. There is RG who is funny, but there are in the novel some other characters, some other institutions, some other practices, some other ideologies, which are equally funny, even funnier than RG is. In fact, the novel is looking askance towards the dehumanizing systems prevalent in post-colonial Sri Lanka. The novel is questioning the ideology of imperialism. The novel is saying that it is the ideology of nationalism which is funny. The novel seems to say, Sam Selvadurai seems to say that the educational system, the institution called marriage, uncles, aunts, parents, and their ways of treating their words, it is funny. The way dominant Sinhalese people look upon the minority Tamils, the way they look is funny. So, Funny Boy, the novel Funny Boy, in this novel, as I have said, funniness is a very critical and complex phenomenon, and the novel resists, as Rick Sorkar pointed out at the very outset, it resists any essentializing discourses implied in the country's national and sexual ideologies. Sam Selvadurai wants to resist such essentialism. Now, before we peg our discussion on the different meanings of the word funny and relate those meanings to the characters and incidents in the novel, let us have an inkling into what queer studies is, very briefly. It's not possible. It's not possible to discuss all aspects of gender studies and all aspects of queer studies within this brief span of time. But let me say that gender studies is broadly divided into two groups. Number one is feminist criticism, or women's studies. And number two, lesbian and gay criticism, which includes queer studies. So queer studies is included within lesbian or gay criticism. And all of you know that feminist criticism is concerned with questioning the ways of patriarchy. Feminist criticism revalue women's experience. Feminist criticism rediscover women's texts. Feminist criticism challenge the representation, the male representation of women as lack or as other. Not only that, feminist criticism also thinks, considers the possibility of a female language, ikricha feminine, according to Ellen Sisu, and so on. But one thing, in fine, feminist criticism is concerned with women and gender. But here lies the difference between feminist criticism and Gatsbian lay studies. Gatsbian lay studies, unlike feminist criticism, is focused on sexuality, not gender. One's sexual orientation is fundamental. It's a fundamental category of analysis and understanding. It has certain common things with feminist criticism, the oppositional design upon society. But lesbian and gay studies resists homophobia. It challenges the heterosexual ideology and questions the institutionalized practices and so many things. But the difference between feminist criticism and lesbian gay studies is that lesbian gay studies focuses on sexuality, focuses on sex, which is not fixed, which is changeable, which is fluid. Now, this lesbian and gay criticism, you know, it is divided into two. It is not a unified field of study. It has two branches. And those are lesbian feminism, number one, and number two, libertarian lesbianism or queer studies. So lesbian or gay studies branch into two. Number one, lesbian feminism, and the other is libertarian lesbianism or queer studies. Lesbian feminism challenges mainstream feminism. It is a reaction. Lesbian feminism rises in reaction against the institutionalized feminism, which tended to universalize the experiences of white, middle-class, urban, homosexual women. So it broke away. Lesbian feminism broke away in certain ways. Broke away from mainstream feminism. So it was a kind of radical thinking within feminism. And the other branch, as I said, is libertarian lesbianism or queer studies. I would like to read out, because this is the area we need to focus on. I would like to read out certain things while discussing this area. Queer studies. You know, in the 1990s, a second, less essentialist notion of lesbianism had emerged, which breaks away from both from lesbian feminism and mainstream feminism. So this queer studies breaks away from, in some sense similar also in some ways, but it also in some meaningful ways, it breaks away from lesbian feminism and mainstream feminism. This kind of lesbianism sees itself as part of the field named queer studies, a term coined by Teresa de Lauretis in her 1991 work, Queer Theory, Lesbian and Gay Sexualities. It is not possible here to recount all the characteristics, to discuss all the characteristics of lesbian, of queer studies, but I would like to concentrate on three or four characteristics, which are, I will discuss such characteristics, such features of queer studies as are relevant for our studies of the novel, Funny Boy. The first and foremost characteristic of queer studies is that it challenges heteronormativity. I read out, heteronormativity is a worldview that promotes heterosexuality as the normal or preferred sexual orientation and is reinforced in society through the institutions. Heteronormativity is a form of power and control that applies pressure to both straight and gay individuals through institutional arrangements and accepted social norms. It rejects, queer studies rejects heterosexuality as the benchmark for sexual formations. Number one feature. Feature number two is that it deconstructs binary opposition. Very dear. Binary opposition is a favorite with a heteronormative society. It draws on post-structuralist tendency to deconstruct binary opposition. And queer studies deconstruct the pair named heterosexual, homosexual, hetero-homo. This binary, according to queer studies, is unstable. This is a kind of anti-essentialism in relation to sexual identity that queer studies prefer. Queer studies disrupts binaries in hopes that this will destroy differences and inequality in society. So this is the second feature, the deconstruction of or deconstructing the binary opposition. Of course, here comes the name of Judith Butler. Judith Butler says that identity categories like gay and straight tend to be instruments of regulatory regimes. She says that the category homosexual itself is a part of homophobic discourse. The term homosexual predates the term heterosexual. So according to Butler, the categories lesbian and homosexual identity are unstable identity categories. I repeat, according to Butler, these categories are unstable, a site of contest and revisions. She says that, this is important. She says that all identities, including gender identities, are a kind of impersonation and approximation, a kind of imitation for which there is no original, she says. What is desired is the postmodernist notion of identity as a constant switching over, she says. So the postmodernist identity of constant switching over is loved by Judith Butler, this idea. And the next category is, next feature is fluid sexual identity. You know, another thinker of queer studies, Eve Sedgwick, argued in favor of this fluid sexual identity. She says, the question of fluidity, as at the outset, Rick Sarkar was pointing out, one may be openly gay in attitude amidst family friends, but the same person may not be so amidst employers and colleagues. The same person may be gay in a given circumstance, or he may not be a gay in another circumstance. So it is not fixed. It's not essential. It is fluid, says Eve Sedgwick. sexual concealment and openness depends upon the situation. Subject identity is necessarily a complex mixture of inner essence, mixture. Sexual identity of the subject is a complex mixture. So, queer theorist contention is that there is no set normal. This is the catchword, the keyword, the key concept, you might say. Queer theorists say there is no set normal. It believes that norms change and it is wise to accept these changing norms. It is wise to accept this fluidity. These are the parameters, basic features of, there are many other features, but I pointed out only three. And the experimentation is also another feature of queer studies, experimentation, experimental sexuality, all these. With this, let's move on to the meaning of the word funny, because that is the focus of our talk. Funny, boy, different ramifications, different meanings of the word funny. One meaning of the word funny is humorous and strange also. Humorous, strange, opposite to each other. Whenever society finds someone different, whenever society finds that someone is beyond its sets, patterns and practices, the society dubs him or labels him, stigmatizes him or her as funny. So sometimes funny means humorous. When it means humorous, it is good, because the word humorous is funny, has positive connotation. It approves, it has a sense of approval. But heteronormative society links funniness most of the times with strangeness, not with humor. Dominant ideology calls someone funny to mean that he is strange. And when you call someone funny, you dominate over him. You rally over him. You know, he is belittled. The person who is called funny is belittled. You do not find yourself threatened by his funniness. So the word funny, the one word of the funny is humorous, but it is not applied in this, it is not applicable to this novel. It has a positive connotation, and the other is strange. In this sense, the word funny has been used in this novel. The concept of funniness may be linked with the concept of gaze. You know, gaze in society is a kind of surveillance camera, you know, gaze. We are always under gaze. Gaze is all pervasive. I give an example. Suppose you are the students on this online platform, the students of Seva Bharati Mahavidyalaya are there. Now, it's a rural college, and the girls of Seva Bharati Mahavidyalaya, they wear shalwar and kurta. But suppose, suppose one of the girls wants to wear, jeans and shirt, usually worn by boys. It may happen. It is worn elsewhere, it is accepted elsewhere, though not in rural areas. In rural areas also nowadays it is accepted. But let us take it for granted that it is not accepted in rural area. If that girl comes to college with this jeans and short, she will be gazed at and will be called funny. Suppose a boy amongst you, he walks with small, brisk steps, not long strides, he may be labeled as funny. And a boy with a funny walk, funny gait, funny style of walking. Suppose your voice is thin and high-pitched, you may be called a boy with meli gola or girly voice. This may happen. So always people are in society always on their gaze, you know, and those who are gazing will stigmatize you, will dub you, label you as funny. This is what, this exactly what happens in the novel Funny Boy. Let us relate this concept of gaze and strangeness, what happens with the novel. What happens in Pigs Can't Fly in the in that chapter? You find that Kanti Aunty is dragged into the game by her daughter Tanuja, and when he comes to the game territory, her gaze, I repeat the word, her gaze fell on Arji dressed as a bride, and she asked, what's this? Very strange, as if very abnormal. What's this? She asked. And Arji felt mortified and felt very embarrassed. Not only that, she dragged Arji against his will from one gaze to several gazes, who were sitting in the dozing in the parlor, much to his mortification. So he is presented as a queer subject, queer object, not subject, as a queer object, as something funny, as something strange, as an object of gaze before all present in the parlor, all. So thus Arji is a victim of gaze in this novel. The concept of funniness may be linked with laughter, you know. Laughter is sometimes good. Laughter has positive connotation. It is healthy. But the laughter we find in this novel is not at all healthy laughter. It demeans, it belittles, it dehumanizes laughter. Let's discuss the text. You know, when Kanti Aunty sees Arji as a bride, she laughs. I quote, as we entered the drawing room, Kanti Aunty cried out, her voice brimming over with laughter. See what I found. With laughter, she says, see what I found. She says, not only that, the entire hall burst into laughter, excepting Arji's parents, who are extremely embarrassed, you know. And then the verdict, the pronouncement is made by Kirill uncle. What does Kirill uncle say? Kirill uncle say, hey, Selva, looks like you have a funny boy here. You have a funny one here. So laughter is another way of saying that something is funny or strange or unacceptable or unusual. Laughter is violent here. Laughter establishes your superiority over the person who is being laughed at, over the object who is being laughed at. Here Arji is the object. Here Arji is the victim of laughter. And laughter suggests that their laughter suggests that Arji is a deformed creature, is something abnormal, as if queer studies, the object of queer studies is to challenge this sort of laughter of heteronormative society. Arji has every right to choose his own game. Meena has every right to play with the boys. Why this prohibition? Why this restriction imposed upon boys and girls? Why this restriction upon boys' fantasy? Queer theory questions such things. Queer theory says that Arji has every right for cross-dressing. He has every right to be different. Queer theory, reacts to the supercilious reactions of society towards a boy's natural inclination. Now, let's the next point is, let's connect the concept of funniness with jokes. You know, jokes is good, but the fact is that nowadays, no joke is harmless as if. Jokes are meant to denigrate others. Jokes are meant to harm others, belittle others, dwarf others. Here also, joke has been used to dwarf Archie. Our sense of humor has become so patriarchal. The sense of humor of patriarchal society, of heteronormative society, is so biased that it cannot cut jokes with anyone in good spirit. That is why when RG is presented before all, when all burst into laughter, RG's father, RG's parents cannot take it jokingly. In fact, none there could take it jokingly. And RG's parents also, they might have taken it jokingly in good spirit, but they couldn't. Rather, RG's father was angry. He accused his wife. He says that it is because of your indulgence that RG has become like this. So instead of taking it jokingly, RG's father says, what does he say? He says, if he turns out funny like the Ranquetwera boy, if he turns out to be the laughing stock of Colombo, it will be your fault, RG's father say. He threatens RG's, RG's father threatens RG's mother. Queer theory looks askance towards this attitude to joke, towards this spirit, which forbid people from accepting many things jokingly. Now, let us relate funniness with the question of respect and friendship. Respect and friendship. You know, heteronormative society say, it is said that women should be respected. Women should be beyond the purview of jokes. Women should be respected, and one should not cut jokes in presence of women. These are exclusionary politics, tactics, you know, in society, heteronormative society. Patriarchal men, they crack jokes about women, on women, they make fun of women, but they will not crack jokes in presence of women. So, it is a strange attitude. But this attitude has been challenged by Archie. The friendship between Archie and Radha aunty is a challenge to the concept of respect. It is noticeable that RG and Radha, enjoy their talk, they enjoy their company because they do not respect each other. There is no respect. You know, they crack jokes. They gossip freely without any inhibition. It is a very interesting friendship, the most interesting friendship in the society. In the novel, where there is the desired mix. In this friendship, there is the desired mix. In this friendship, Radha aunty is heterosexual, but she challenges certain standards of heteronormative society. And supposedly, RG is homosexual. So this is a funny kind of, strange kind of friendship between a heterosexual woman, lady, and a supposedly homosexual boy. And they enjoy their talk. This friendship is a kind of mix. So queer theory says that in the relationship, sexual relationship, respect is not important. Rather, intimacy, laying bare one's own heart. Rather, respect does damage to relationship. And respect is a way of sidelining, is a weapon in the hand of patriarchy to sideline women, to sideline queer people, you know. Coming to Archie, let's define, since he is the novel's protagonist, all the chapters, what we find in this novel is Archie's experiences. What is Archie sexually? In Archie, you cannot say bluntly that Archie is homosexual. Yes, there are homosexual leanings in Archie, as I have already discussed. But in him, you find a lot of patriarchy also. He nurtures in him certain patriarchal ideas. For example, comes to know that Radha aunty is coming, he imagines like a patriarchal man in the patriarchal society, like a boy in the patriarchal society, he imagines that Radha aunty will be like Malini Fonseca, who is a known actress and parliamentarian. So he is dumping some gender stereotypes on Radha aunty. So that is why he is very frustrated when he sees Radha aunty. When he sees Radha aunty, he expects someone very glamorous, but he finds that Radha aunty is different, and he is a little bit shocked temporarily for the time being. This shocks. Why shocked? Because he nurtures in him certain assumptions of patriarchy. Not only that, he equates romance with marriage, you know, which is done. Romance and marriage are two things, but he equates romance with marriage. He jumbles up, you know, these two things. He does not understand that romance has little to do with marriage. Marriage is a social, serious, something serious in society, you know, and marriage is a part of the patriarchal society. Romance and marriage are not the same thing, but he equates romance with marriage. Nobody has told him that romance and marriage have nothing to do with each other. As I was saying, marriage is socio-cultural construct, and romance is different. And Radha aunty, the name Radha is affair between Radha and Krishna. Here there is no trace of marriage. It is romance. Okay. So, in Archie, what I was saying, in Archie, you find a mix. On the one hand, you find in Archie his inclination for Sehan, his homosexual tendency. On the other hand, you find in him certain heterosexual tendencies also. He looks at his mother, you know, while she is dressing. This is also in him one tendency of patriarchy. So in Archie is a queer in this sense. You know, this contradiction in Archie makes him a complex character, makes him a mixed character. He's a mixture of the two. Nay, he's a mixture of the many elements. Now, another interesting character is Radha aunty. In the Radha aunty, many assumptions have been, Radha aunty is an interesting character in the novel. Radha crosses many boundaries. For example, she crosses the boundary of gender and becomes the friend of a young boy. She crosses the boundary of sexuality while she befriends a supposedly homosexual boy, she crosses the boundary of class when she befriends the maidservant Janti. She crosses the boundary of race and ethnicity also when she thinks of marrying Anil, who is a Sinhalese. So in many ways, Radha aunty challenges the assumptions of patriarchal society. There is a conversation. Amachi, Radha aunty's mother, you know, slaps her and forbids her to have any relationship with Anil. She says, Amachi says, "You think this is funny?" "No," she replied brightly, "I think this is serious." Kanti aunty challenges his mother, you know, and Radha aunty challenges his mother. And when she is asked whether she loves Anil, who is a Sinhali, she says, "No, I don't know. The funny thing is, I never thought of him like that until Amma started to make a fuss. It was only after the event, after we went to speak of his parents, that I began to see him differently." So Radha aunty is a very interesting character in the novel who challenges the assumptions of heteronormative patriarchal society in many ways. In him, it is said that RG is the funny boy, but Radha aunty is a funny woman in many ways. Funniness extends to Radha aunty in a very, very unsuspecting way. It has been in Radha aunty. Sam Selvadurai has brought funniness in Radha aunty, you know. So she's funny in a positive sense. She's funny in the sense that she has the capacity to challenge society. Now, let us, perhaps my time is flying. within 10 minutes or more, I'll conclude. Let's relate the concept of funniness to the concept of binaries of male and female. Male-female binary, this essentialist concept, is loved by the patriarchal society. You know, queer theory challenges this binary. I have already said, you come across one character named Tanuja in the chapter Pigs Can't Fly, who represents this binary, among others. There are many, but I have chosen to focus on this male-female binary. This focus on this character, Tanuja. Tanuja, when he comes to the game, comes to play, participate in the game, bride, he finds that RG is the bride. RG has been accepted as bride. So she cannot accept it. She says that, "Why? I am the girl. I should play bride. Why you?" So it is through Tanuja that this binary between girl and girls and boys, between man and woman, is represented. You know, areas, front area, back area also is there. Front area meant for the boys and backyard meant for the girls. So this binary is very much there, and Tanuja says, "I am a girl, I should be the bride." So see, Tanuja wants to bring a sense of normality to the game. But this is funny, because the game is already normal, because it has already been accepted normal that RG will play the role of the bride. Other girls and participants in the game have accepted it as normal. But Tanuja, a representative of society, though very small, in her own way, she says that I am a girl, I should be, right? This is abnormal to allow RG to play the role of bride. Not only that, she castigates, she attacks RG, saying that you are effeminate. She says that you are fagot. She says that you are pansy. She says that you are sissy, another term of derogation. You know, these are words. Actually, she borrowed these words from Western society. She came from abroad. She learned these things there. And she brings all these things onto this bride game. You know, Tanuja represents this binary, which queer studies purport to break, which queer studies purport to dismantle, purport to erase, you know, this binary. Then let's conclude with that question. Who is funny in Funny Boy? Who is funny? Sam Selvadurai wants to say that R.G. Selvaratnam, though some funny tendencies are there, but he is not funny in a harmful way, in a dangerous way. I mean, Sam Selvadurai wants to say that it is the heteronormative society. It is the ways of society. It is the binary concepts which are funny. And the characters in the novel are victims of this binary, are victims of this norm. Let's discuss the characters a little bit and conclude. Sam Selvadurai wants to say that RG's father is funny. RG's father cannot accept his son's cross-dressing. He cannot accept his son's penchant for playing with the girls. This is because there is repression in him. There is obsession in him. There are some unhealthy elements in him. She is taken in, possessed by the heteronormative society, by the patriarchy, in such a way that he cannot enjoy. Perhaps during his adolescent days, he experienced this sort of experienced kind of suppression and repression. This repression forbids him to accept his son's behavior as something enjoyable. He cannot take it jokingly. Sam Selvadurai wants to say that parents in the society are funny, the ways of the parents. Why? From the very beginning, from the very childhood, parents say, don't run after frock and salwar. Don't mix with girls. Avoid girls. But one day he says, one day parents say, here is a girl for you. You may marry, or you have to marry this girl. How funny it is, you know. Parents say, do not befriend, do not mix. Do not think of sexuality. Avoid sexual discussion. Beware of sex, etc., which is central to life, not denying the fact. So, words, boys and girls, are forbidden to talk about sexuality. Boys and girls are prohibited from ideas of sexuality. But one day, they are expected to have sexual experience with their wives and husbands. How can you ask them? This way of society, this attitude of society is funny, according to Sam Selvadurai. So parents are funny. Arjit's father is funny. Arjit's mother is also funny. When Arjit's mother indulged Arjit in certain ways, but when she is rebuked by her husband, she says tells Arjit that you must not come to my room while I am dressing. It was a terrible shock. I quote, "It was clear to me that I had done something wrong." Guilt consciousness within Arjit, mother's behavior, creates this guilt consciousness. Arjit says, "It was clear to me that I had done something wrong, but what it was, I couldn't comprehend. I thought of what my father had said about turning out funny. The word funny, as I understood it, meant either humorous or strange. And as in the expression, 'that's funny,' neither of these fitted the sense in which my father has used the word, for there had been a hint of disgust in his tone. So he is afraid of the tone of his father. He cannot understand, this small boy cannot understand why his mother is forbidding him to enter while she is dressing up." So Arjit's mother is also funny. Auntie Doris is funny. Auntie Doris advises Radha auntie. Auntie Doris says, "Life is a funny thing, you know. It goes on whatever decisions you take. Ultimately, you have children, don't have children, and then you grow old. Whether you are married, you married the person you loved or not, seems to become less important as time passes." You know, Auntie Doris herself married for love. Hers was an interracial marriage. But now she confesses. Now she advises, admonishes Radha auntie that you need not go for this sort of marriage. It is futile. So she is funny. She herself has done that. She knows what is wrong, right and wrong. But still she is accepting the norms of heteronormative society and advising Radha auntie accordingly. So Auntie Doris is also funny. To conclude, another funny with another funny element, a funny institution in the novel, Victoria Academy. You know, Arjit was sent by his father to Victoria Academy because his father wanted Arjit to be manly, to be like a boy, you know. But Victoria Academy, an institution, educational institution, is not at all an ideal place. Victoria Academy, it is dominated by dominant ideologies. There is rift among the teachers, rift among the principal and the vice principal. The students belong to respective lobbies. What a culture. The students, you know, can you imagine? There is Tamil class, there is Sinhala class. Sinhala students cannot enter Tamil class, and Tamil students cannot enter Sinhala's class. So this binary, this essentialism is there in the school also, in the school atmosphere. Victoria Academy, the term Victoria Academy, it is reminiscent of colonial imperial rule. And many of these things, many of these binaries, many of these concepts, including nationalism, imperialism, heteronormativity, sexual binary, are borrowed from the West, Western concepts. So this novel brings in many issues, you know, and it is in this academy, Victoria Academy, that Arjit meets Sehan Soiza. Sehan Soiza's hair is cut forcibly by the principal, and Arjit protests. "It is not fair. It is funny. It is unacceptable," he says. Arjit says, "So there is corporeal punishment. If you cannot recite properly, you will be beaten. If you break any discipline, you will be beaten. So the principal will beat you. So Ways of Victoria Academy is also funny. And there is another character, Jagan, paucity of time is not possible to. So I conclude with this observation that the novel's funniness is a critical phenomenon. RG is not the only funny character. Rather, RG is funny in certain meaningful ways. But other funny characters, there are other funny characters in the novel who are threats to society, whose attitudes to boys are not acceptable. The novel makes fun of the ideologies, the essentialist concepts, the power structures that sides with imperialism, that sides with nationalism, and that sides with neoliberalism. So the answer to the question, who is funny in Funny Boy, is that there are many funny aspects in the novel, there are many funny persons, and the novel's funniness is something critical, it's a critical phenomenon. With this, I conclude my rather simplistic kind of talk meant for the students.
Thank you, sir, for your such a wonderful, brilliant exploration of the multiple aspects of funniness in Sam Salvadori's novel Funny Boy. Now, you have rightly pointed out the socio-cultural mechanisms that is behind the construction of the notion of funniness. And you are right. And you have rightly pointed out or foregrounded the power politics, gender politics, sexual politics within the society that determine the notions of laughter, strangeness, jokes, respect, friendship, etc. We usually think that these are some of the ideas which are fundamental human values or human aspects, but you have rightly pointed out that those notions, which we usually think to be abstract ideas, are basically constructed by the sociocultural conventions.
Right.
And apart from exploring the diverse elements, theoretical aspects of feminism, gender studies, lesbian studies, queer studies, you have also explored or foregrounded how binaristic notions of male and female is also a patriarchal construction. And finally, you sounded Freudian when you emphasized that the sexual issues are fundamental to human life. One cannot simply ignore the basic instinct of man. Now, this is a brilliant exploration of the queer aspects of the novel, and your analysis is clinical, and you have excellently explored the multiple aspects of funniness in Sam Salvadori's novel Funny Boy. Now,
thank you.
We express our hearty thanks and deepest gratitude. Now, sir, our departmental teacher, I mean Mr. Reek Sarkar, has some queries. Now, I am just adding him to the screen, and I request Mr. Reek Sarkar to put your question to the speaker.
Okay, am I audible?
Hello.
Am I audible?
Yes, yes, Rick, you are perfectly audible.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you for this wonderful deliberation, first of all. The lucid and the simple ways by which you have dealt with the theme of the novel and then went on to discuss the theoretical underpinnings that govern the novel is quite astounding. I have two questions for you. One is that you know, being part of the larger diasporic community, you know, Sam Salvadorai, who has spent a considerable portion of his life in abroad, do you feel he enjoys a kind of an artistic freedom by which he can comment on these political issues, the civil war, the sexual identities, without being politically correct? That is number one. And the number two is that since you have spoke about the jokes and the patriarchal connotations that underlie jokes, do you feel that the memes that are currently the social phenomenon, the memes that are can be seen in Facebook, Twitter, these memes, do you feel that there is a kind of a hidden sexism that informs these memes that now are being circulated, you know, as part of generating laughter? So these are my two questions to you, and hopefully you'll be able to satisfy my queries.
Yes, thank you for your questions. Both the questions well emanate from my paper. I appreciate the two questions posed by you. As the first question, you have rightly said that whether this diasporic writer, Sam Salvadorai, would be at liberty, would be at freedom to write in such a daring way, to write in such a, challenging way, had he been in Sri Lanka. Yes, I agree with you that his diasporic status, the fact that he is away from the place about which he is writing, gives him an advantage, gives him a privilege, you know, to look askance towards certain aspects. But at the same time, I'd like to say that creative writers, wherever they might be in the world, at which place, at which atmosphere, you know, they have the special power, they have the special capacity to challenge. You know, whether Sam Salvadorai would be the same person, the same challenging writer, had he been in Sri Lanka, it's a question of surmise. But I think that the fact that he is away from the scene he is depicting gives him an advantage. And would you repeat the second question? I couldn't get you properly.
Yeah. Since you spoke about the jokes, the funny aspects of the novel, and there is a kind of a hidden patriarchal notion that goes with it.
Right.
The memes, you know, the memes that are part of the Facebook phenomena, memes. Yes, the memes that are part of the Facebook phenomena, and there is a kind of hidden sexism that goes with these memes that goes unnoticed. So would you like to comment on that, the kind of hidden sexism that is part of, you know, these memes that are being circulated online through Facebook, through Twitter, all these things?
Definitely.
Since you have brought in the concept of...
Yeah. Right, you have rightly pointed out. You know, memes who are visible on social media, Facebook, Twitter, you say, if you think deeply, if we look at this, look at the memes properly, we can understand that memes poses a challenge to society. You know, in their own ways, they make fun of the ways, the oppressive ways of the heteronormative society. In their way, they assert their differences from the normal go, from the normal, assumptions of society. So memes, it's a kind of challenge. They look queer, and in their queerness, in their strangeness, in their newness, in their novelty, they challenge certain assumptions. This is my take on the question you have said.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir, once again. Now, such an interpretation of the text from queer theoretical point of view will help enormously the students in understanding the text and motivate them to explore the novel from multiple perspectives. I strongly believe this. Now, I am confident that the participants, particularly the students of fourth semester, will be hugely benefited by your lecture, as they learn a lot of things from such brilliant discussion.
Thank you.
I express my sincere thanks to all the participants who chose to be live with us with great interest and made this lecture a grand success. Now, thank you, sir. Thank you all. Now, I request Mr. Rick Sarkar, Assistant Professor of the Department of English, Seva Bharati Mahavidyalaya, to offer the vote of thanks.
It is my honor to propose the vote of thanks on this occasion. On behalf of the Department of English, I am very grateful to Babulal Mahato, Mr. SDO Jhargram, administrator, as well as an important member of the governing body, for his unflinching support. A mention must be made of Honorable Principal Dr. Dev Prasad Sao, whose words of inspiration will go a long way. The Department of English is privileged to have Dr. Devdas Roy, departmental head, as well as associate professor of Sukumar Sengupta Mahavidyalaya, Keshpur, Poshchim Medinipur, and we would like to have you in future for further talks. And a special mention is to be made about the teachers of the department, Mr. Lokhikanto Chatterjee, Mr. Tonmoy Sarkar, Mr. Shubhankar Acharya, who have worked tirelessly in order to make this a grand event. And finally, to the participants, including my dear students, who I think will be benefited immensely by this lecture. With this, we move to the end of the web lecture. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Namaskar.
Thank you for giving me the chance to speak and for being with you. It was indeed a pleasure to be with you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you.